session for 6:55. Next on the agenda is a hearing of school district patrons. Do you have any requests to make comments?
We have a question.
Could you please read the policy and address the board?
Excuse me. Addressing the board. If you wish to address the board during a board of education meeting, please note the following guidelines. Individuals may speak to the board during the hearing of district patrons. Each speaker needs to identify him or herself by name and address. Speakers need to limit their comments to 5 minutes. If the speaker represents an organization or group, he or she should indicate whether the comments represent the official view of the organization or are his or her personal comments. If a delegation is present to address the board, the delegation may be asked to select up to 5 representatives to speak on his behalf for a total of not more than 15 minutes. Written statements should be given to the board secretary and are considered public documents. If you wish to state a complaint against the board member, employee, or student, an initial allegation is permitted. Thereafter, the affected individual may request that further discussion takes place in a closed session pursuant to the Open Meetings Act. In general, issues brought to the board's attention will be referred to the superintendent for investigation and study, and a response will be provided at a later date. These guidelines are based on the Massachusetts Board of Education Policy 0167.3, public participation at board meetings. So we have four. We have Mary McGinnis.
I'm Mary McGinnis. I live at 110 Bellevue in Mount Clemens, 48043. I'm here to talk a little bit about school of choice. 3 years ago this month, I received a call from my bishop. I'm a United Methodist clergy person, and was told that while Tawas had enjoyed my stay and my time there, it was time for me to move on and to go to Mount Clemens. And so right away, being the parent of a 10 and 12-year-old children, I immediately started looking at schools that I would be involved with there. I take academics seriously and had a bit of concern about the city I would be living in. As I started looking at my options, there are some things that were important to me. I needed a school district with a strong academic background, one that prepared students well for college, because college was not an option. My children are going to do that. I needed sports options for my girls in case that was avenues they wanted to pursue. What kind of fine arts were available and what kind of music was there? Their father and I are both marching band people and have dreams and hopes for that. We'll see if that's their dreams and hopes. But as we looked at surrounding school districts and options of places to send our children, we noticed that Lance Cruz really rose of the ones we were looking at. Not only were we strong in all of those areas, but classroom size was wonderful. And as I started looking at even like the websites for the middle schools, I was so impressed, especially with South, Middle School South, and how they seemed to be a family and friendly, and they had young teachers, and that was just very attractive to me, the message that the principal had on their website. And then I discovered something that really made you stand out and above anyone else in the area, including places we would pay for our children to go. And that's the connection you have with the Mandarin program and those connection with other schools in China. My children are both adopted from China. I traveled halfway across the world to complete my family. I'm very thankful for that opportunity. But part of that process includes standing in front of those that are allowing me this precious gift and vowing that I will take education seriously and I will do the very best I can to provide education opportunities. And so when I was looking at where to send my children in the midst of where I was being asked to move to, I was so thankful to have a choice like Lance Cruz to fulfill that promise to them and to myself and to my children. And so as you discuss school of choice tonight, I want you to have the face of children in front of you and what they look like and how they are making a difference in your school district. My children are both at Middle School South. I have a sixth grader and an eighth grader. My youngest, when she left YACS last year, received their highest education award through the Presidential Pen and Academic Achievement. She's on cross country. She's never received a ZAP. She has excelled in all of her classes and is in any advanced classes that are offered for sixth grade. My oldest has been at YACS, or at Middle School South, all 3 years. Played basketball, volleyball, cross country. She has advanced classes when they're offered. She just received her in-step scores, and she's an advanced in every subject, which most of the students there, I think, did not excel to that degree. She's a junior National Honor Society student and a leader in her class. And when you're having this conversation, and I know there's different sides of every story when it comes to school of choice, this is my daughter, Eleanor, and I want you to think of her face when you're thinking of things, because your school district is better because she's here. Because of who she is, not because of what I've created her to be. She's an excellent student, good leader, and Lance Cruz is preparing her to do the things and have the dreams she wants to have as she moves forward into this world looking for college opportunities and then graduate programs. Thank you for giving me opportunity tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you. Jennifer?
No, Watson.
Miller. I was not going to get that. I was going to go to Miller.
Good evening, Board of Education. Thank you for your time today. I wanted to thank you, the members of Lawrence Cruz School Board, for supporting School of Choice programs and making Lawrence Cruz Schools a true education destination in Michigan. Lawrence Cruz Schools Public School of Choice program creates a better learning environment for all students by recruiting students wanting to achieve at a higher level and recruiting parents that are offering support and resources to support that achievement. When my daughter was in preschool, I began researching all options of education opportunities for her, not only in the county, but outside of the county. She received scholarships from Cranbrook, Roper, and other schools, but we decided to choose the Lawrence Cruz Schools our home. At the age of 3, my daughter was able to read at a fifth grade level chapter books. She is a violin virtuoso. She's already in an orchestra at the age of 6, and she is a proud member of the South River community in the first grade. I would be remiss to say, if you drive by South River, her name is on the marquee right now. She has over 200 fish tickets, for those of you who know the fish philosophy, and also received the golden fish ticket. As a parent, you want the best for your child, for them to receive their full potential. Because I believe we as a society, at the end of our days, whether it's our doctor or the nursing care worker holding our hand, don't care what zip code they came from, but rather did they get the morals and education that they needed to be the best person that they could be. Olivia, being in the first grade, is someone who I think cares about other students and tries to work to make their education better. In the first grade, she's already going down to kindergarten, tutoring kindergartners in reading because of her advanced reading level. She's a positive force in her school, and we are now part of the South River family. My husband and I volunteer regularly, we fundraise, we work at different events because we believe we are part of that community. Just so you know where our street is, we are only about 6 houses away from the Lawrence Cruz educational community. I believe Olivia and my family, through our involvement, make South River a better place, not for her, but for all students that go there. I would ask that tonight you continue making Lawrence Cruz an educational destination. And when you make education a destination, it increases your property values in the Lawrence Cruz district, and it increases all student achievement by making it a place where the brightest and best compete to get into. I have every single day since January 1st been on your website trying to make sure I don't miss any kind of opportunity to get my preschool daughter, Audrey, into Lawrence Cruz schools. Because the school of choice parents are on top of these things. We don't let enrollment happen to us. We are fighting every day to find out the opportunities, the enrollment, the dates, and making sure we go through that process because we care. I would ask that you continue to recruit the brightest and best students by opening up school of choice and making Lenox Groups a place, as your motto says, where we work together so everyone succeeds. In conclusion, I would like to quote former President Ronald Reagan on the issue of school of choice. Choice in education is the wave of the future because it represents a return to some of our most basic American values. Choice in education is no mere abstraction. Like its economic cousin, free enterprise, and its political cousin, democracy, choice affords hope and opportunity. And of course, I would be remiss not to say thank you to all the wonderful teachers that touch my daughter's lives every single day, in particular Ms. Elliott, who is one of those teachers of a lifetime in South River. Thank you.
Thank you. Dorothy Moore.
School districts, businesses, townships, and cities, a public body, or a person acting for a public body, shall not during the period 60 days before an election in which a local ballot question appears on a ballot, use public funds or resources for communication by means of radio, television, mass mailing, or pre-recorded telephone messages if that communication references a local ballot question and is targeted to the relevant electorate where the local ballot question appears on the ballot. So some people are calling this a gag order. That's some things you're hearing in the media and with others. Because what it basically does is 60 days before an election, it says that school districts and other local agencies cannot use resources to provide the facts related to a ballot question. By law, we have never been able to use tax dollars to talk about our opinions. But to educate on the facts of issues is something that not only have we been allowed to do, it has been expected of us. When we have issues that need to be discussed that impact our community, it is our responsibility to make sure that people are aware of it. And we also understand that people receive communication in very different ways. Some people will go onto our website to find out information. Some people are waiting for us to push out an email to them. Or perhaps they're watching us on TV already, well, TV issue right now, but it's coming back. Or maybe they like us to put something in their mailbox. So people have different needs. It's our job to make sure we reach our community in all the different ways that work for them. Until now, this bill, as I mentioned, I think hit the news on the Wednesday before we went on break. March 8th, when many people have elections, including Lance Cruz, 60 days, which is what this act requires, was last Friday. So we virtually had 6 days from the date that they took action on this, 6 business days from they took action on this until it went into effect. Many of the people who were responsible for it, people who voted on it, indicated that they weren't aware of this portion of the bill. It was part of an amendment that happened late in the dialogue, and they are saying that they weren't aware of it. Some of them actually called the governor to say, hey, let's veto, why don't you veto this and let us take another crack at it. It was signed because there's other language in the bill that people thought it was necessary to continue on with. But again, a very shocking, in my opinion, we are expected to be transparent, and that expectation is in the law. If you go on our website, you will see we have a little transparency button. All districts in the state of Michigan do, because we are required to provide a lot of information to our public, because they're your dollars. This is your public schools. And so while we have all these laws that require additional transparency, which we agree with, at the same time, which, of course, we're doing as we're doing all of our work, which means through district resources, at the same time that's occurring, we are advised 6 business days in advance of it happening that we are not allowed to talk about our elections. I share that with you because it's just so concerning the way this worked. And I want to make sure everyone knows about it, because I don't feel like we'll be able to do all of what we should do, and I wanted to explain why. So I just wanted to share that with you. Again, that is Senate Bill 571, which now became Public Act 269 of 2015, because it already signed in 2015.
I have a quick question about that. So at our board workshop, right before the break, we had a 15-minute presentation from Epic MRA about which demographics we should be looking at in order to get the most bang for the buck from basically asking people to vote. That was $20,000 for that 15-minute presentation. This bill does nothing to prohibit things like that, right?
Just to clarify for individuals, Epic MRA did do a survey of our community. It was in order to get a statistically valid representative sample of our community that could be extrapolated. It was 400 individuals, and you are right, it did cost almost, it cost about $20,000. It is a very expensive thing to have at MRA do that. They did work around two things. They did help us understand where people were on the millage issue, not only whether they supported it or not, but also what additional information was needed. And they also asked other questions about the education. How are we doing? What do people like? What kind of feedback do they have? The law would not change this. It's really surprisingly about our ability to communicate with our community. That's what this law talks about.
Thank you.
That's no one's fault. That was already in the works, already being done before this thing even happened.
It's $20,000 when we're cutting positions at $10,000.
But Mary, this happened before.
All right, one at a time, please. Sharon?
All I wanted to say was the other part is in terms of transparency. I know that a lot of people probably don't understand this, but for districts to get the full foundation allowance from the state, by state law, they're required to do an 18 mil ballot proposal. So they require us by law to do it, to get full foundation allowance, and now they tell us we can't let anyone know. I don't know about you, but that's just amazingly stupid.
So to spend
$20,000. Thank you. Is there any other board members who would like to have some discussion on this? There is some movement by the legislature to modify this. The governor, in the statement, had asked for them to come back. I would suggest, anything that you see come back is what is called a patch or a repair to this. You read it very critically to see if it actually addresses your concerns and communicate with your legislators and the governor on the impact of any legislation, including this, to your local district. It does, I believe all board members that as we take on, take on the responsibility to participate, learn, read, and communicate, we take that obligation very high. Listening to the public through, whether it's through a survey or through personal communications, is part of the responsibility of the board. Now that we hold that we have a limit on what we can do, I'm very concerned on any of those board members, if you read the law, and please read the law as it's stated, because it does reflect on each one of us. This has now been enacted by the state and can have impact not only to the district, but our personal liabilities of board members in this legislation also. So please, as in all cases, excuse me, please don't interrupt me.
No, I'm wondering.
I'm sorry, would you please let me finish my comment? Thank you. Please, it is responsibility we know of all board members to read, understand, and participate with the law, not only our policies, but we take an oath to follow the law. So please understand that there can be consequences to both the district and you personally under this. And again, I find that very compromising. Board Member Hilton, would you like to make a comment?
I'd like to get back to the agenda, that's all.
So I was just taking the same exercise that you were, and I appreciate the kindness.
No, actually, you did a soliloquy, I asked a question.
Thank you very much. On to the next item for the superintendent.
Thank you. Okay, the second item I have is related to board policy, and I just want to remind everyone where we are. So, a couple of times a year, NEOLA sends us updates for consideration. Some are by law and where we need to approve them, and others for consideration. And we had so many board policy updates, we actually divided the policy in half, and we brought half of the board policy revisions to you, I think, 3 meetings ago, and then the other half are coming to you next board meeting, so that's a little teaser. So what we have before us today is when we came to you a few weeks ago with the first half, there were five board policies that you asked us to go back and do a little bit more work on. And so we did that. And what we have today are 4 policies. We have 3 that were presented to you previously plus a new one. So the 2 that came off of the list are graduation requirements. We heard from the board that it wasn't really, we need to work on what we're going going to do, that it wasn't really okay to take all of our specific grant requirements and put them into administrative guidelines. So we just need a little bit more time to work on what that's going to look like. So we want to meet the board's expectations, and we're not there yet on grant requirement board policy. The second one is internal controls. We were told by Wayne Peters from NEOLA that there is a new policy coming out early in 2016, next month or so, that is really going to replace what was previously presented. And he said, put that on the shelf, something's coming soon. So those two are gone. Now let me just tell you about the ones that we had before you. So 144.1, you remember that we had a conversation about, about the review by the treasurer about board compensation documents, and that the treasurer's expense report would be approved or would be countersigned by another board officer. So you can see that we incorporated that. Then if you go down to, I'm just kind of scrolling through on the next highlighted one. I apologize. The request was also made to highlight those things that are required by law, so thank you for that reminder. You'll see what if it's in yellow, it means it's required by law. So under board policy 140, page 15 of 17 on your screen, the first part is required by law. You might remember last time you saw this, there were two options made available to you. One option was to put a dollar amount right into it. Another option was to use the IS, the amount. The intermediate school district board members have a limit that is allowed per law for gratuities, for lunches paid for by vendors, things like that. So that's what we put here, is that ISD legal limit, which I believe is $56 right now, and apparently has stayed at $56 for a very long time. So that's what's here. The reason only half of this board policy is in gray is because there were options available, so I just wanted to point that out. And then if I keep scrolling, you might recall that our last meeting, as it related to the removal of the expulsion program, there was a suggestion that board members should be made aware if we were going to be moving students who have been expelled into our online program. We added that sentence in, otherwise the changes are as it was presented to you previously, and we did talk about how students who are expelled and who are on our online program will never be in school at the same time as the students at the Pelham Center, where they sometimes go after school hours. And then the final one I wanted to present to you is a new one. So you might remember when we were talking about that dollar amount in the prior policy, and we were talking about what dollar amount we wanted to put in there, because there was an option. Somebody referenced another portion of the board policy and said, well, let's look at that guidance. I think that that's a pretty low number, and we want it to be a pretty low number. So when we went over to 6460, we actually saw that the number was higher. And so this revision here, which this is the first time we're seeing this, changes the approval from $100, for some kind of gift or lunch or whatever, down to that ISD limit, which I believe is $56, but it's set by the Department of Education. So we're actually bringing that dollar amount down to meet the conversation that occurred last time. So what we would ask is that you approve these policies as a first reading, if they would meet your expectations, and then if that's true, we'll bring it back to the next board meeting for a second reading.
Okay. Is there a motion to approve the first reading of the policies presented and on the agenda tonight?
So moved.
Support.
We have a motion and a second. Is there a discussion on the motion?
Yes, up. Go ahead, Amy.
On the vendor, the 6406, it said it struck out $100, but you didn't put in the dollar amount. Should we have a dollar amount in there?
Well, what this says is, and I'm just reading for those in the audience, board members and school personnel shall not accept any gifts in excess of the amount established annually by the Michigan Department of Ed with respect to the amount above which an ISD administrator may not accept a gift from a vendor or a potential vendor. So basically, we're not using a dollar amount, we're letting the Michigan Department of Ed's annual action, whatever action they take annually that works at the ISD level, and we're accepting that for ourselves. Now, we aren't required to have a number, and we certainly aren't required to have a number like theirs, but it makes sense to me if Michigan Department of Ed is going to go through a process annually to set a number for this other group, why not just use that? And for right now, it's $56, and apparently it's been $56 for a long time, so.
Okay. I'd just like to make a comment that you know, this district is tied to the MISD tighter than any district in the county. You know, many of the original people who formed the MISD came from Oshkosh. And we've always had, and we've been lucky in that way, that we've always had one of our board members also sit on their board. And right now that happens to be Don, our president. We've always had someone there representing. I've always thought it was an advantage because we have a great insight into what's happening not only at the state, but the county level because of that. We have input because of that. I mention that because I think this just cleans up and clarifies, because many times you think that some of these people are only representing ones who they are, but they're representing the county, they're speaking to the state where a lot of these changes are coming from. And I think it just, this is a great idea to take confusion out and not put any of our people in harm's way, because we don't want a conflicting number amount from our board and the MISD, which we've been very heavily involved with. So I support this. I think it cleans up an issue that, and gives us a dollar amount for all of us, so no matter where we're at. It's not a gift so much as sometimes being at a banquet and having someone there sponsor. You know, or you're at a workshop and somebody sponsors your meal for you, you don't know what the cost is. So I feel comfortable with this, and there's a dollar amount. If you check on it, if it's more than that, then we'll pay the difference or whatever. So I like having an amount.
Is there any other discussion on the motion?
Yeah. Policy 56-1001, expulsion of a student. We don't have an expulsion program. We have expelled a student from this school in the last year and a half at least. The only thing that we've done is we've allowed Mrs. Johnson to move these students into the Pelham Center. Moving these students into the Pelham Center demeans the Pelham Center. It means what they do over there. We don't have an online school program. We have online credit redemption that's done at the Pelham Center for students that need the help. They need the extra work. Not for students who have broken rules so severely that they have been asked to be expelled from the school by our school administrators. This doesn't support our school administrators. This is completely inappropriate. It demeans the Pelham Center. And the only purpose of this is to keep their money in the district, to keep their foundation allowance here. I would hope to God that this board is not so money-grubbing for the foundation allowance our students that have been expelled to roll with us.
Okay, is there, I think that begs some response. I'm not sure how many of us would like to. I know I would. Let's see, who hasn't had a chance to talk yet? Chair? Please.
I was just going to say that in my time on the board, I do not recall any time that we had a recommendation that we didn't follow. I did not really handle some of those. I do not recall ever having a recommendation come to us that we didn't follow.
From the committee or the?
Coming all the way from the interview, from the investigation, from the recommendation.
Okay, who else? Anybody else would like to make comments? Professor Hoover? Or Member Hoover's on the floor. Thank you.
You know, we're one of the few school districts in the state that has an alternative education program. In addition, we have also a GED program where kids who really can't function there still have hope. The one thing you want to do as an educator is not take hope away from our kids. And so these kids are going through, and families are going through trying times. And I've always felt proud that Lawrence Cruz tries, we say, to put our kids first. Well, this is one of the reasons we put the kid first, and sometimes they're a victim of something that we can't always see at the board level, but if we can offer them hope and we can give them opportunities to, you know, compete here, either our two traditional high schools, our vocational high school, our, you know, just learning programs, you know, we try the best we can to service that kid. I mean, we service the jail, you know, with staffing for kids who are there. So I've always been proud of us crews in trying to do that. Sure, we get the money, but you know, many districts have went to the extent that our colleagues have voted on these things, and we've been able to build not just a vocational center, not just a foreign rights center, but prettiest and the nicest, the most efficient and well-staffed in the state. So I think it's great that we can do that. And if they run out of room here, they're, you know, then there's something else in the future, but I'm proud that we do what we do.
Board Member McPatrick.
Yeah, I would agree with Mr. Hoover. You know, why do we sit on this board? We sit on this board for the kids and the students of our community. And if we're going to have to expel a student, you need to tell me that we're going to tell that student there cannot be any learning done for that 180 days that you are out of school. As Superintendent Johnson spoke earlier, the students that are expelled are provided with online classes through the Pelerin Center. They are not attending the Pelerin Center. It is online at their home. And if you've ever sat on a reinstatement committee, and I hope some board members get an opportunity to sit on a reinstatement committee, you will hear them say how valuable that education was to them. Many times, like Mr. Hoover said, they were in the wrong spot at the wrong time and got caught up in something that created this expulsion. I'm not going to tell that student or that person that for a year they cannot get any type of educational experience and assistance from Lance Cruz. And I think it's imperative and important that we continue that act that we're currently not doing.